Bartle Hall was a great idea in theory, and we met our goal and objective of the winter of having nobody die on the streets of our city because they didn't have a place to stay. Bartle Hall at some point ended, and the hotel program we did this spring at some point ended. Through those two things, we provided a lot of services and support to people who did not have it. Where are they after that? There are still people that we weren't able to serve.
I grew up in foster care. I moved constantly. I have emotional and psychological issues where I can't maintain a place to stay very well because I'm always terrified that someone is going to come and tell me it's not home anymore. I lived in my vehicle for a long time. I would just drive around the country. Somebody stole that. So if you see my van out there, it's a white 93 Ford Econoline 150. Yeah, I'd like you back. Without a home, your brain shuts down and goes into just survival mode. You can only think of the very next thing that you absolutely need. You gotta pee, that's what you think of until you get done peeing. If you're hungry, that's what you think of until you can only go from point to point to point. Planning ahead falls out the window. And you start making poorer decisions, not because you're less smart, because your brain functions on this level that says, look, I've only got this little bit of whatever, and I'm gonna enjoy it as much as I can. And you end up, it turns into an instant gratification thing. So I recognize the difference in stability. I feel it when I have stable housing. I see the change in the way my brain operates when I have stable housing. I was part of the hotel initiative, so those 3 months were nice and stable. At the end of the hotel initiative, less than a third were housed. Instead of creating some sort of situation that provided housing for these people and prevented homelessness, they put them right back out on the street. We still wanted to be visible, we still wanted to make a point, so we moved to Ellis Davis Park. They swept us 3 times there. There's no dustpan for us, do you know what I'm saying? You're just pushing dust around the house. Until we have homes, we have nowhere to go.
The pallet shelter order is actually completed. It's been completed for a couple months. It's sitting in Washington. When Verge first started being in planning, we met with different HOAs for months and just said, hey, we're in the area. We're talking about building this project somewhere around Northeast, or could be in the East Bottoms, West Bottoms. We're not sure. We just want to keep it somewhat centrally located. And everybody was super supportive right out the gate. They had a special committee that was created. And then when it went to City Council as a whole, that's when kind of the naysayers were kind of twisting their own council member's arm, saying, no, we don't want this because it's going to be too close to our neighborhood. That wasn't ever the plan. We've actually been looking at commercial zone properties since the start. And then it was like more pushback, like, well, this is going to cause too much crime near the neighborhoods. When in reality, police departments in cities that have done this are showing a huge drop in calls. Just like KCPD has thousands of suspicious party calls, a lot of those would start going away if there's nobody suspicious hanging around downtown who's really just a houseless guy trying to be warm.
People see tents and they see homeless people living in certain places out on the street, and they ask cities to remove them. But they also don't want to build facilities and structures and resources locally in those neighborhoods. They're everywhere and they're in all neighborhoods, and we need to provide those types of services and housing and support in all neighborhoods.
We are here because we want to utilize our knowledge and our experience to change the way they do things at the top of the hill. You know what I'm saying? A housing first approach, get them off the street. Creating that stability is the first step in being able to find out what's really wrong.
The system is set up for you to go from street to shelter, from shelter to transitional living, and from transitional living to permanent housing. But there are massive barriers between each one that prevents success from happening, that prevents street from becoming permanently housed. Let's just start with shelter. Shelters fill up really, really quickly. If the doors open around 5, you need to be in line around 3 o'clock. If you're not in line at 3, you will not get a bed. So what does that do for your job prospects? Do I quit my job so I can have somewhere to sleep tonight? Or do I keep my job and I sleep on the streets? And it's a barrier that's in conflict with what the general public believes that homeless people should do. They should work. Now, let's go from shelter to transitional living. So think about all the things that you need to get into an apartment. You need an ID, you need credit history, you need references. I have never met a homeless individual that hasn't had every one of their identifying documents stolen while at a shelter. You have to attend classes, there's often a religious component, and you have to do UAs frequently. They're gonna look and see if you've done drugs or alcohol. And if you fail that UA, you don't go back to the shelter, you go back to the street, and you have to start that entire process over again. Now, let's say you manage to get all the way through TOP, and you have enough money saved, and you're able to go into permanent housing. Let's describe the type of person that is effective through this system. It's someone who has gainful employment from the hours of 7 to 3. It's someone who has all their identifying documents. It's someone who doesn't drink or smoke. It's someone that has good references, has good credit, and is able to routinely keep a schedule. Because it doesn't sound like we're describing people who need help. It sounds like we're helping people who have it pretty good, and they send you back to the streets with this thought, that'll show them. That'll show them. Next time, they won't do that. But on the streets, what are they getting? You sleep about 3 hours a night. It's unsafe. You're not eating. You're probably self-medicating. You're probably gonna lose your job. How are you gonna pay for that phone that you got? You need to stay in communication with the network that you're building. It's a failed system. It's completely failed, and it's backwards. And that's why moving permanent housing closer to street is the right move.
My name's Jamal Collier. I'm from Kansas City, Missouri. Been homeless 3 years, and now I'm with the Lotus team, Lotus Care House. There go the little Lotus cat. She's pregnant. It makes me feel invincible. It makes me feel like it's the reason why I'm working 3 jobs. It's the reason I want to keep going, because it gives me an opportunity to be outside of myself, but then also to be able to have somewhere safe to come back and be myself. And that's everything, man. And I was a waiter for 5 years. I got laid off because of COVID. When you actually want to go look for work, it doesn't come easy. Yes, I have felonies. Yes, I'm big, black, got tattoos. So a lot of those are bad marks for me. And even though I paid my debt to society, some people are intimidated by that. I can't really see a way out of that other than to really build a community. This right here is the closest I've seen, and that's the first for me.
Hey, what's up, Dakota? How are you?
So what we're trying to do is really define kind of what the values we hold here at Lotus Care House. What do you think are the 6 most kind of values that resonate with you?
Humility, community, creativity, balance, stewardship, compassion, growth, and resilience.
I think there's been a lot of lessons learned this past year. The Navigation Center is just one part of a housing employment ecosystem that we're trying to build. Figuring out how do we all work together, because we all come from very different points of experiences, different points of expertise, but how do we really work through those challenges so that, more importantly, no one dies this winter and that we can keep people safe.
The gears of government turn slowly, to be honest, but they do turn. And we are making some progress, and we're really excited about, over even the next few weeks, some initiatives that we're going to announce here to build more permanent housing, things that we've never had before, and to incorporate it into our standard practices of finding homes for people. You know, we're still in the final stages of doing the RFP evaluation process on it, related to building permanent supportive housing at a large scale in several parts of the city. We're hopefully soon going to be hiring for the first time, first ever tenant advocates, first ever people dedicated to homelessness support and reducing homelessness, creating and preserving affordable housing, staff that we've never had dedicated to this stuff. We're collaborating with KC tenants to make sure that we get the right structure in place to make sure that those new residents have the rights and responsibilities and authority that they need to live self-sustaining, sufficient lives in their homes to make sure they were doing it right.
The city is eager to do anything, do something about it, you know. However, you know, time is sensitive right now and we have to act accordingly.
We not out here trying to die. The cavalry ain't coming. We all we got. Winter's coming. Every day is getting a step closer and we don't know where the city stand or nothing. And we in a race for our lives, you know.